I am Ludovic Noiry from Nokia Bell Labs, working on control and management of networks. And one topic that is of interest for me as an exploratory research is quantum internet. And this is why today I present something about quantum key distributions. And quantum cryptography and quantum key distribution protocols. So the outline of my presentation is the following. I will first talk about qubits and Bell pairs before discussing the which is the main content of this presentation, the BB84 quantum key distribution protocol. That is the first protocol that was proposed in the literature by BB is for Bennett and Brossard, the co-author of the paper that was published in 1984. I wanted to present another one, Eckert 91, and but I will not have time to it is too complex to present, so I will not present this. You will have the slide if you want to see what we can say about it, but I will not have time to present it today. And I will conclude with today's and future quantum key distribution systems leading to quantum internet and quantum networks. So before starting, I just indicate that there are some references. So the BB84 protocol is this publication from Charles Bennett and Gilles Brassard. They implemented this protocol in 98 in an experiment. It is the first experiment about quantum cryptography. The other quantum protocol that I will not have time to describe is this one, the quantum cryptography based on Bell's theorem by Arthur Eckert. And the three of them published, co-published, in fact, a paper in Scientific American in 92. Explaining what quantum cryptography is. So you will have the material of this presentation. You will be able to get the links to if you want to retrieve this publication. There are other publications, I will not go in detail here. The publication I put there are about Bell pairs, entangled qubits. You will see what it is to, later. And the Bell's inequality violation that leads to the to this year's Nobel Prize in Physics for Alain Aspect, Alain Aspect, in fact, which is a French researcher in optics and quantum optics, and French professor on it. And they get the Nobel Prize for this for some experiments, and you will see that the experiment of Alain Aspect is something that is really interesting to consider for the quantum key distribution. You can reuse this experimental testbed to proceed to quantum key distribution with the BB84 protocol. There are other articles on quantum physics. I put the links here. I will not go too much in detail here in my presentation, oral presentation. Yeah, there are some Wikipedia pages. Sometimes it is easier to read what is in Wikipedia pages, so I put them here also. And there are some talks at links on related topics. There was the first presentation made by Filippo Mathieu, who were in 2017 about the real first with quantum mechanics, in which it explains the Bell's inequality. I presented quantum internet on another reading group presentation in 2020. Don Tosley was invited in a seminar beginning of this year about the quantum internet and the recent advances and challenges. So you have today's presentation on quantum key distribution by myself, and next week Michel Barbeau will have a seminar on the will present something on the Link seminar next Wednesday about quantum networks also. So you have the links. You will have the links after my presentation today. I will put the material on the website. There are also other videos which are in French, Science Étonnante YouTube and website. One on BB84 protocol itself, and two other ones considering which are about Alan Aspect experiments. The first one is a vulgarization presentation, and the second one is the full interview by David Blois, Prof. Alan Aspect. They are quite interesting to listen. If you understand French, it's good to see them. Now, let's go to the content of this presentation. And first, I will talk about qubits. So there are qubits so this is the outline of this part. I will first describe qubits as 1/2 spin particles in the block sphere. Then I will explain that polarized photons are also qubits, in fact, and with the Poincaré sphere, which is in fact equivalent to the block sphere. Then I will talk about measurement and time evolution of non-entangled qubit. And in practice, how can we modify and measure photonic qubits? Photonic qubits being polarized photons. So qubit as 1/2 spin particles. What are they? So 1/2 spin can be viewed as an interesting angular momentum. So the angular momentum in physics is the rotation speed of a spinning object. And the spin can really be seen as an elementary object that, like if it is, it was spinning, if it, it's not really the case, but it's really behaves with the rest of the world, like if it was turning around some axis. Some oriented axis in the 3D space, but with always a constant value. And so for a given axis, you can measure plus or minus this value, h/h divided by 2, because, so do you see my camera? I will try to show. So if you have two spins that are turning like this, when you return the spin, then it turns in the opposite impact. So saying that one spin is turning with minus with the negative value is like if it is like if it was turning into with the positive value on the opposite axis, in fact. So this is what is a spin, and it's nothing else. And the qubit state can be represented in the block sphere because you have an oriented axis, so you can it corresponds to a point in the sphere in 3D space. And if with spherical coordinates, you can represent the point by a vector with this spherical coordinate values. Two orthogonal states in the Hilbert space are the two states that can be measured with plus and minus value for the spin. And this corresponds in the block sphere to opposite vector, in fact, to opposite point in the sphere. The convention is that when you consider one orientation axis, if you have the positive value when you do the measurement, it corresponds to bit value 0. If you have the minus value, it corresponds to the bit 1. This is the convention. And you have a one-to-one correspondence with unitary vectors in Hilbert space up to a phase vector. In fact, in the Hilbert space, for those who know a bit the formalisms of quantum mechanics, this state corresponds to this state in the Hilbert space with a phase vector that can be chosen arbitrarily. So in practice, because of this phase factor, the qubit quantum state corresponds to rays in Hilbert space, and they are exactly they correspond. They have the same topology, the same metric, the same topology, and the same structure, mathematical structure, as the sphere in 3D space. But this will be more clear with the block sphere representation. So you have the block sphere representation here. So any qubit state is one point on the sphere that can be written, and this one with angle theta with the z axis and the angle phi between the x and the projection of the point on the xy plane. this corresponds to this qubit state in the hyperspace. So you have a one-to-one correspondence between a quantum state and a point in this sphere. The z-axis corresponds to what is usually called zero and one, the canonical basis, and it corresponds to spin up and spin down. And then it's really this really represents the orientation of the spin axis in 3D space. The y-axis then is the horizontal spin on the right. On the opposite, you have the horizontal spin on the left. And in front of us, you have the x-axis, which corresponds to a spin rotating in the the opposite of the clockwise direction from us. And in the opposite, you have the rotation in the clockwise direction. So and just to so here you have zero and one. This usually what x is the spin corresponding to x. Usually we note it plus minus for the opposite and plus y and minus y for the right and left. And if you want to translate this in terms of quantum vectors in the hyperspace, space, it is something that is written like this by replacing the star by plus minus plus y and minus y in this formula. So a spin is an orientation in a sphere. This is what you need to remind. But spin can also be realized with photons. But photons, they are bosons. They are not one half spin particles. They are photons. They are bosons with spin one. So usually, spin one can have three possible spin outcomes: minus one, zero, or plus one. That you multiply by the slashed h constant, the Planck constant, normalized. But because of relativistic effects, the photon goes to the speed of light by definition. The spin zero is forbidden. So there is only two possible states, and they behave like one half particles. So they can have plus or minus h spin and any superposition of them. So it's really because of the spin zero is forbidden, the possible state in the Hilbert space are the ones that are on the subspace of dimension two, which is exactly the subspace to model one half spin particle. So the photons really behaves like one half spin. And so you can realize qubits also with photons and therefore. And I forgot to say that the spin corresponds in fact to the polarization of the photon. It's exactly the same. And more generally, a qubit can be any quantum system that after measurement, there are only two possible outcomes. Okay, that is just a blah, blah. So here again, you can represent the polarization with on a sphere that is exactly, so you have exactly the same sphere, but the interpretation is a bit different. The z-axis corresponds, so the point on the z-axis corresponds to the circular polarization, left and right, and the x-y axis corresponds to the linear polarization. And the other point, the half sphere, upper half sphere corresponds to left elliptical polarization, and the down half sphere corresponds to the right elliptical polarization. So you have a one-to-one correspondence and between the way to represent the polarization on the sphere, the Poincaré sphere, and the representation of qubits of half spin particles in the with the block sphere. So this is important because, as you will see, we will talk about photons that will carry the qubit information. And you will see that in the experiment, we will limit to polarization that are linear. So we will do some measurement according to the XY axis plane in the block sphere or the Poincaré sphere. How do we measure qubits? So you can perform the, multiple measures on a one qubit, but the first measure that you will produce, you need to know what could be the result and which probabilities. So we consider a measurement. So we have a qubit in a state S, and we consider a measurement according to another oriented axis M. And the possible results will be plus or minus M with some probabilities. And these probabilities, the probability to measure M with initial state S is equal to 1 plus the scalar product of M and S in the Bloch sphere divided by 2. So we are talking of the representation here of the representation of the qubits in the Bloch sphere. And this corresponds to the bit value 0 by convention. And the other probability to get minus M will be 1 minus the above probability. So we change the plus by minus in the formula. And why do we have this? We have this because if you calculate the probability in the Hilbert space of the usual quantum mechanics formalism, you obtain this formula with Hermitian products, and it is equal to the square of the cosinus of the angle in the Hilbert space of the two states, the two vectors in the Hilbert space. By changing by using some cosinus identity formulas, you can see that this is equal to 1/2 plus 1/2 of the cosinus of 2 times the angle, and 2 times the angle in the Hilbert space is exactly the angle of the point between the two vectors in the Bloch sphere. In fact, the projective Hilbert space. Is isometric to the Bloch sphere by considering twice the angle for the distance. This is a property of the Bloch sphere. You have really this is why I said that it is exactly the same structure mathematically because of this property. And so this is why the cosinus of the angle between the two representatives in the Bloch sphere correspond to the scalar product of the unitary vectors in the Bloch sphere. So this, I said this, it may be appear a bit complex, but complicated. But in fact, if you can forgive, you can avoid considering things for big qubits, avoid considering things in quantum, in Hilbert spaces, and just consider the Bloch sphere and make calculation with the representation of the qubits in the Bloch sphere. It may be easier for some calculations to do that. If you have successive measurement, how does it work with quantum mechanics? So imagine that you consider measurement with axis M1, and then after there is, you will get so plus M1 or minus M1, and then you will do a second measurement. So how does it work? So for the first measurement, it is like we said before. And for the second measurement, then with probability P1, you start with a new state, which is M1, and then you apply the formula with M1 instead of S because the state changed. And with probability 1 minus P1, it is you obtain minus 1, so, and this is why you apply the formula with minus here. And when you do the calculation, it can be so the formula is easy. It is the product of the scalar product. And so you will have M2 with this probability and minus M2 with the same probability changing about the same probability changes the plus symbol here by the minus symbol here. And if you reverse the order, you start with M2 and M1, you will have other, so the order, this is just to show that the order of measurement is important in quantum mechanics. You really change the state. It's not the same if you measure first M1 and then M2, or first M2 and then M1. So the formula are the same, but you just exchange one and two symbols, in fact. Okay. I will skip this. Now I will speak about the time evolution. time evolution in quantum physics governed by the Schrödinger equation, which has this shape. And I don't know if I need to go into details. So you will see what I want to say is that at the end it is a unitary transformation, because for this equation, so you have the vector state at time t here, and the derivative of it is equal to a Hermitian operator, which is the Hamiltonian, multiplied by the vector, and you have the I slash h symbol before the derivation here. If h is constant, this is the case for isolated systems, you can solve it is easy to solve the equation, and then you obtain something. You obtain that phi of t is equal to a unitary operator multiplied by the initial state at time zero, where the unitary operator has this shape. You may have also, if the Hamiltonian depend on time, then you will have something a bit more complex, but it is still a unitary transformation, because this equation conserves the norm of the vector, and it is linear. So in a complex, in the Hilbert space, you have something that you multiply by a unitary matrix to get the qubit after the evolution. In the block sphere, what is this transformation? In fact, it is simply a rotation in the 3D space. So for each unitary operator, you can find a rotation according to a given oriented axis and a given angle, depending on time, to get what is the spin in the block sphere after some evolution. Considering evolution of qubits, it's simply the rotation of the spin. It's simply this is the main message of this slide. The evolution is deterministic. There is no change in the amount of information an observer has on the observed system. In fact, with the equation of Schrödinger. How do we modify and measure photonic qubits in practice? So photonic qubits are photons in which the qubit information is carried by the polarization of the photon. So how do we modify a photon in practice? So modifying a qubit is a quantum processing of qubit, and it is really, so it's rotating its quantum state in 3D space, but for the polarization, it corresponds to modify the polarization. And this can be done using what we call wave plates. There are some materials that are birefringent. Birefringent material is a material in which the propagation of the light inside depend on the axis of the polarization. And there is a slow and fast axis. And the dephasing is proportional to the length. So you can adjust the dephasing of the two polarization by changing the length of the wave plate,
there is a problem. I don't understand why there is something that is not written here. I don't understand why there is a problem here. Okay. Just in another way. Ah no, sorry. The formula appears only for the half wave and quarter wave. Sorry for that. So if you select the length L of the wave plate to be in such a way that the dephasing is the half of the wavelength of the light of the photon, then you will have half wave plates, and this corresponds to a rotation of pi according to the x-axis in the block sphere representation. So Concretely, if you have the polarization, so the polarization may be if you orient the wave plate according to the horizontal and vertical polarization, this polarization will not change. But if you have diagonal or anti-diagonal polarization, there will be exchange. And if you have circular polarization, there will be also exchange because of the birefringent material. On the contrary, if you orient the axis according to the diagonal and anti-diagonal polarization, this time this diagonal and anti-diagonal polarization will not change. Only the and what will be changed are the vertical and horizontal polarization and also the circular ones. For quarter wave, in fact, it's only you will have another rotation with angle pi divided by two, which exchange. So if you orient the axis according to the horizontal or vertical polarization, this polarization will not change, but the diagonal will be changed into circular and the circular into diagonal in the opposite way. So you will recover the initial polarization if you by using four quarter wave plates, because a full wave plate doesn't change the polarization. There is no change of the polarization if you by applying twice a half wave plate or four quarter wave plates. So here, by combining the quarter wave plates, half wave plates or quarter wave plates, you can obtain any unitary transformation of the qubits corresponding to any rotation in the Poincaré or block sphere, any rotation of the polarization. It can be realized in free space with the wave plates. The name comes from this. Is this there are material in which, for a given thickness, you obtain quarter wave plates. If you double the thickness, you can obtain twice the wave plates. In fiber, it is what we call a Mickey Mouse hairs. Yes, it is obtained by a quarter wave plate is obtained by having a loop of fiber of a given diameter. If you do have twice loops, you will obtain half wave plates. And this is something that people who do some experiments in optics in lab knows very well, this kind of object. It's very useful if you need to control the polarization. But this can be also automated. You can use electro-optic waveguides that you can control with voltage, and according to the voltage, you have the same effect. And I think so. This is for to change the state of the qubit, photonic qubit, by changing its polarization. You can also measure it, and to measure it is really easy. You can use a beam splitting polarizer and two photodetectors. And this is something that is used in the Alain Aspect experiment. Here, I just keep one figure of one of the paper of Alain Aspect in 1992. And you have a beam splitting polarizer. And according to the polarization, a proportion of the photon will be, if the measure photon is measured in the right axis, it will go through. If it is measured in the other axis, if the measure is the other state, it will be reflected. And you have two photodiodes here, so you can detect using this detector, you detect the state of the polarization of the photon according to the axis of the beam splitting polarizer. Is it a zero or a one qubit? Now I will talk about Bell pairs. So I am too fast here. Not the right way. So a Bell pair. What is a Bell pair? So a generic Bell pair is a maximally entangled pair of qubits. What does it mean? So you have two qubits, A, B. And what does it mean that it is maximally entangled? It just means that there are a maximal correlation between the qubits, which correspond to one bit of correlation information. I will explain the consequences of this later. And why are they entangled? It's because they interacted totally between themselves in such a way that because of this total interaction, the previous information one observer could have had on the qubit is lost. There is one bit entropy for each qubit. So the observer, with a Bell pair, the observer has no information neither on qubit A or neither on qubit B. You just have one bit of information with the fact that they are correlated. And what does it mean? The one bit of correlation, this means that if the observer measures the qubit A, then this observer could infer the state of the other qubit. It has no information about the individual qubits, but it has a global information about the two qubits that are correlated. And measuring one just will give an information about the state of the other of the other qubit.
What is the total interaction?
It's the fact that the way I see the things is that the two qubits interact, and because they interact, each one has one bit of information. So they interact, and the total information is that the one bit of information is lost and replaced by a new information.
But physically, if it's photons, so what does it mean?
It's easier to with one half spin qubit to understand it. Photons, they are created, and the way they are created, it is not a direct interaction between the two photons, but with an atom, and the atom will produce these two photons. We will see later. The entanglement is between the electron in the photon and the photon that is emitted, and the electron lose the interaction and transmit this interaction to the other photon that will be emitted, and at the end the two entangled photons will be the entanglement will be with the two qubits carried by the photons.
Okay, this is a conservation rule which makes
it. You can say that. It's a bit. I don't know if I am very. It is exactly what it happened, but it's a bit like it. So, what I mean, yes, maybe it is not well explained here. The qubits interact either directly or by some intermediary system. And with this, the observer, they exchange one bit of information each, but the information is confined within the Bell pair. Each one has an information about it. This is the correlation information. But because they exchange the information and one bit of information each, they lost the previous information they could carry inside them. And the external observer has no information neither on one qubit nor on the other. And he needs when he will measure. So this when he will measure the each of one or the other qubit, he will get one bit of information. But because he knows that they were correlated, he can infer the state of the other. And this is when I say that this explains what happens when we measure a Bell pair.
So who is Bell?
Bell is John Bell, who was a researcher in Geneva, at the CERN, and he published a paper, the first paper showing that there are some inequalities that, for hidden variable theory, should be respected. A value should be lower than 2. And in quantum mechanics, there are some configurations in which it is violated. It is bigger than 2 times square root of 2. And Alain Aspect proved in his experiment that quantum mechanics is right, they are violated. So you cannot have local hidden variable theory behind the quantum mechanics. It's not possible. So So Bell comes from this from John Bell who first published inequalities about that. So with what I said, if the qubit A is measured according to some given oriented axis MA, MA, we obtain one additional bit of information. So with the Shannon formula of entropy, it's one half. This corresponds to probability one half to measure MA, or one half to measure the opposite minus MA in the block sphere representation. And because of the one bit of correlation information, then it can infer the qubit states, which is a given function. For the moment, we don't know what is this function. And because of some information-based consideration, F must be an isometry in the 3D space of the block sphere, because the angle between the qubits correspond to a distance that evaluates the distinguishability between the qubits. And for such Bell pair, it's not possible to distinguish. It is not more easy or less easy to distinguish the two possible qubit on one side or on the other side. So the angle must be conserved. So it is it must be an isometry. This corresponds to the Wouter statistical distance. I put the reference in my slides. And there are two kinds of isometry in 3D spaces, which are related to unitary or anti-unitary operators, according to some theorem in quantum mechanics, which is called Wigner's theorem. The rotation and what is called the improper rotation being the composition of a rotation with a rotation. So the first one conserves the orientation in 3D space, and the other one inverts the orientation of the basis in the 3D space. Okay, so F may be, for the moment, we can say that M, F may be this one or this one, rotation or improper rotations. But quantum physics, I don't have physical intuition to say that, but we can prove by calculation that it must be improper rotation. It cannot be a rotation, it should be an improper rotation represented by an anti-unitary operator. So now we know that for a given Bell pair, Bell state, the inferred state is the image by an improper rotation of the measure state, because it is an improper rotation. You have plus minus here. You can put the plus or minus in front of the function, and removing the sign here. Because it is in the proper rotation, it is it conserves the angles. So the angles between the two states is pi in the block sphere. It should be pi also in the image. Of state. Of course, you can measure B, the qubit B instead of A. You will have another improper rotation that is the inverse improper rotation is the rotation with the same axis but the angle in the opposite direction.
So I understand this Bell production. So you produce the two things, then they go their line, and then you measure one. But I see no timing thing.
No, you will see that the timing is not important. You will see that. You can measuring one or the other. The order of the measure is not.
I don't mean the order. I mean things propagate. You lose the measurement time at a certain epoch, I mean, can you do that in a thousand years or a
minute? In theory, yes. For photons, it is possible. In fact, photons are, if they are not, we measure photons coming from very, very far from the space.
Yeah.
So for photons, it may be a long time between the emission of the photon and the detection of the photon. And the reason is that in the photon frame, time-space frame, time is zero, in fact, is frozen. Time is frozen. So it will not be modified in this frame, but for an external observable, the state of the photon at the emission and at the reception will be the same. Maybe there will be some rotation because the things are turning, but you will have a one-to-one unitary transformation between them.
Okay, I understand that. But so yeah, so these two things are photons which go there at night with the dynamics of their whatever speed. And so if you measure one at one time, then you know some information on the other one at the same time. That's what
At the same time for the first observer.
For the first observer.
Yeah. It's but there is no information transfer.
The
object. But you know an information because of the correlation.
If there would be an observer, if there would be somebody else able to measure the other
with the same axis,
okay,
you will obtain what you infer. With another axis, you will obtain something else.
Okay. And so, okay. And these things evolve over time, but at a given time, you know what would be the state of the B. If you measure the state of the
other
given time, would be the state of B somewhere else
that
you don't care, right?
If you know how the photon propagates, you know how it will be transformed, so you will know precisely what you should to measure.
Okay. So, because the system is purely, in a sense, deterministic. It shows that the system is purely deterministic in itself.
The first measurement is not deterministic. You have one half in terms of probability, the measurement. But the inferred state is deterministic if you know the measure, the outcome of the measure.
That's
mind-blowing. So Belpaire is characterized by this. I will have to speed up a bit. So the Belpaire is characterized by the improper rotation. If you do measurement of two qubits, so what happens? Imagine that the qubit A is first measured with axis MA, and the B will be measured with MB. So I said that with one half you have MA or minus MA, so you will have the image by the improper rotation of MA and minus MA in terms of inferred state. The second measurement you measure on B, so you measure this, so you will start with 50% of change of probability, 50% you will have this state, so you can say you can calculate the probability to have minus MB. And in sometimes you will have minus this state, and you can calculate the so it will be MB. And with this, you will get minus, you can get minus. Je me mélange les pinceaux. Because you measure with MB here, you can have MB or minus MB, so you can have the four possibilities. Plus 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 minus minus plus and minus minus, and for the probability you can use the formulas that we have with the measurement on one photon, but you are divided by four because you have one half first with the first measurement plus one plus sigma divided by two with the second measurement. And so sigma is really the formula that the scalar product that we obtain that I showed with one qubit measurement. So this is the way to calculate the four outcomes. If you measure first B and then A, after the first measurement, you will have something that is different from here, because you measure MB and you will have the inferred state on A. But then when you will perform the measurement on the qubit A according to Access MA, we obtain the same possibilities with something that may be different. You have sigma prime, but one can show that sigma equal sigma prime. I need to speed up, so I will not go into the details of this. This is what is written written here. So yeah, I was a bit too fast. Here you have why we have this equality. So the two measurement commute, whatever the order you proceed, you will obtain the same results. And this is can be explained because of the locality of interaction. A measurement is an interaction with the qubit. The two qubits are separated, they are localized in different places. So measuring in one place and measuring in the other place, they are independent because it is separated. It is spatially separated. What are the usual Bell pairs? We can represent them like this. And I will just explain this one. I need to speed up. This is the one that will be interesting. In this one, in fact, the Bell pair is characterized by the improper rotation of with plane XY and rotation axis zero. So it's just a reflection. The reflection with according to the plane XY. Because it is the reflection of the plane XY, if you measure according X or according to Y, you will have the same state. So you see that it is here you have 1100, and here you have 1100 in terms of bit value. On the Z axis, they are inverted. But they are inverted. If you have one, you have zero. And if you have, there is an error here. It should be inverted. Arrow should be in the opposite, and this arrow should be up. In fact. And this corresponds to 101 and 10 here on the Z axis. So why we will consider this? This because the XY plane in the Poincaré sphere for the polarization correspond to linear polarization. And this is what we will be used in the, it is easy to use the linear polarization for the experimental, to perform experiments for with quantum key distribution. Well, I will go first here. I will not, Bell pairs in practice, it's more, so this, I want to create this Bell pair, and I will explain this on the figure that will follow. So we use, so this is taken again with another paper of LSP in 1981. So we, for the source of entangled photons, he used a material with calcium atoms. And the calcium atoms, if you pump the material with two lasers at this given wavelengths, precise wavelengths, one which is in the purple domain, purple light, and one which is in the blue light, then the electrons will be excited and will go to this upper level of energy. And when we reach this upper level, it can then the electron will decay with fluorescence effect, will decay in twice in cascade. First with this blue, a bit slightly different wavelength, but with this blue photon, and another purple photon, which is a bit different here also compared to this. In fact, the sum is equal and it corresponds to energy conservation in terms of. It's not what is conserved is the frequency, the energy. The energy of these two photons, or the two first photons, is equal to the energy of the two other ones. And the second decay is very fast. On average, in 5 nanoseconds, after he had emitted the blue photon, it emitted the purple photon, and because of this cascade, the two photons are entangled as you want. But, they are entangled photons. So this is the way it was realized in LHSP experiment. It is a way also that can be used for quantum key distribution. And so this one is important. Also, so we use this Bell pair. conserving the polarization on both sides when there is a measurement on linear polarization. And so you see that if you perform you perform the same measurement on axis measurement on both qubits, you will get the same value, 0, 0, or 1, 1. And this is the way, but it is random because the measurement gives a random, the first measure, the measurement gives a random value. So it is a way to produce a random qubit that is shared between two parts. If the choice of the axis are different, because then you can do the calculation. And what happens is that the results of the, you may have 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1 in terms of results of measurement by Alice and Bob on the qubit A and B is what is explained here in fact. So if the polarization of the two photons are measured with the same linear polarization, vertical or diagonal, then you have 0, 0, or 1, 1 with 50% each time. If you have different orientations, vertical, horizontal, or diagonal, anti-diagonal, so vertical or diagonal, or diagonal and vertical in terms of axis, then you will obtain with 25% of probability any combination.
So just for distribution. So, if you
are, I will explain the protocol later. I will explain this is the principle. What I want to say with that, this is why I wanted to speak to speak about qubit and Bell pair, is because with a Bell pair, you can you correlate the qubit state that are one qubit being belonging to Alice, one the other one belonging to Bob, and by if the measurement are in the same axis, then you have a shared secret bit 0, 0, or 1, 1. If it is not they do not correspond, then you will the value will not be used because it can be 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, or 1, 1. They may not correspond.
And one more thing. So you have your calcium, which then is a thing. And so but how do you select the two photons of the Bell pair?
By adjusting the laser pumping, you can adjust the rate of production of such a photon. At some point, you have a rate that is slow enough that you will receive photons in a period that is about so you, I said that it is 5 nanoseconds the delay for so you need to be sure that the photons that you receive are correlated. So if you decrease the pumping energy to a level such as on average, we produce one Bell pair each 1 microsecond. For example, there are enough separated that you are sure that there are other bells. Okay. This is an important point. Well, I will go fast here. So I want to talk about BB84. So BB84 is really what I said. You use this Bell pair. So you need to choose some axis of measurement for the polarization. So they choose X and Y. X corresponding to the vertical polarization for the value, the bit value 0, or the horizontal polarization for the value 1, and Y corresponding to the diagonal polarization for the value 0, or the anti-diagonal polarization for the value 1. And for Bob, in fact, Bob will select also the same axis, same choice of polarization axis. This is due to the choice of this Bell pair. And here is the protocol. So Alice and Bob receive a qubit each of the Bell pair. Then they choose independently and randomly their axis of measurement. So there are four possibilities. to choice and to choice. And they process the measurement of the qubit according to the, to these axes. And so here, if the axes are the same, they say by chains, they select the same same axis, then they get 0, 0, and 1, 1, with probability 1 half for each. And this can be used to create the shared secret key. If they are different, then the result will be dropped because you can have any of the configuration. This is what I explained in one of the previous slides. Then they select the choice of axis through a classical channel. An important aspect is that the classical channel must be authenticated. It may not be encrypted, but it is authenticated in such a way that there is no eavesdropper that can be in the middle to change the value that will perturb the things. We will see what an eavesdropper can do, what Eve can do later, but she cannot change the what is exchanged between Alice and Bob, and Alice and Bob knows that they are in communication and it is they are communicating together. And so they communicate the source of axis and they select the qubits for which they choose the same axis to build the key, in fact.
And again, this question of timing. So they do their measurement. Do they have to do the measurement at the same time?
They need to know when the photon arrived, and they need to know that it may not be the same time, but it may be they must know what is the first photon and what is the last photon that they should receive. And there is some synchronization. You need to have some synchronization to be sure that the two photons they are considering are the same. So there is a labeling of the photon, of photon by timestamp that is not carried by the photon itself. It's just by the time the photon are produced. When you produce the Bell pair, you know you regularly produce some qubits. And by synchronization, Alice and Bob knows that the first they should receive the first the photon at this time, the next photon a time after, and so on.
To identify which are elements of a pair.
Yeah.
Right. But then they also have to perform a measurement. Do they have to perform this measurement?
No, because the state there are photons. The state of the photon is not changed. Along the period of transmission, they know that if the polarization is changed, you can. It's a bit complex. We go in details here. We can copy that. If there are changes, we can copy that. Here we suppose that they do not change.
They just have to learn that these are from the Bell pair.
If the polar, if there are some effects on the transmission on the polarization, it can be compensated. There are ways to compensate it. And there are slow effects. So in times, it's not varying a lot. So they will correctly measure the 0 or 1 bit for each polarization. So we are almost finished in time for the time. So I will go fast. I think it's almost everything, in fact. Or this, I will go fast. What I want is here is to summarize the possibility. So in terms of measurement, they can choose 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, or 1, 1. 0 being the choice of one given set of axes and 1, the other set of axes. The probability is 1/4 for each. In terms of measurement, they can measure 0 or 1 for each. But some states in red are forbidden by quantum mechanics. If they select the same measurement axis, the probability to measure different qubits is 0. In fact, this was it is red. And so you have 1/8 and 1/8 probability here to have this this combination of 0, 0, 1, 1 with axis 0, 0 and here. Here, the same for 1, 1. And if they select 0 or 1, it is in gray because the result will be dropped. It cannot be used to create the key. with Eve as a eavesdropper, what can she do? She can intercept or modify the qubit transmitted on the quantum channel. So here you can have a man in the middle attack on the quantum channel. She can intercept the information exchange between Alice and Bob on the classical channel, but she cannot change it because it is complicated. What can she also knows the choice of the Bell pair and the choice of axis also of Alice and Bob. You can suppose that also. So it's a quite strong hypothesis, and we will show that any intervention of F will be detected by Bob. How can they detect this? So we must add some step in the protocol. Once Alice and Bob have measured the qubit that they received in step two, and they have communicated the choice of axis in step four, they will select a subset of qubits, and only for them they will say, okay, I measure this. For the rest, no, the rest will be used to create the key. But she will sample, Alice and Bob will sample the set of the results in which they choose the same axis to see if everything is okay. And because if Eve has modified, has measured and made some modification on the qubits in the middle, it will be detected with a probability that is greater or equal to 1/4. We will show that later, not completely because we don't have time, but in the presentation that I will give after this talk, and I will put on the website, you will be able to see that. And this allows to, because and the probability, so the probability that the corresponding bits are different, it should be zero. And if F does something, it will be greater or equal to that 1/4. And with this fact, Bob and Alice can evaluate the proportion of qubits that have been modified by F statistically. And so here you, there are some processes that are a bit described in this paper that allow purification for a given amount of qubits that have been intercepted by L, that you know that may have been intercepted by L, you can do some purification in the qubits, some operation on the bits that you received in such a way that you will decrease the amount of information, so you will decrease the number of qubits of bits, but then you will decrease the amount of information F could have gained by the intercepting these qubits. And in the end, you create a key that is with a very, very low probability. Very, very high probability information. F has no information at all on this key. So the proof, I will go fast. The proof is given by this table. In fact, you can consider, in fact, so here I consider that Eve measure according to the axis corresponding to bit zero, meaning vertical axis for the polarization. And if you do, and that she sent to, so she intercepts the qubit of Bob, and she sent to Bob the qubit that she received. This is her strategy here. And when you look at all the possibilities, you see that there are some configurations here that are interesting. Alice and Bob choose the same axis. Elle choose a different axis by random. And there are some, so by doing that, the bits that are that will be measured, because Elle choose a different axis and send to Bob the result of her measure, the two bits that Alice and Bob will get maybe different with some probabilities. So it is 4 × 132 here, so 1/8. But because so the probability of detection is 1/4 because you consider we evaluate this probability only for the case when A equal to MB, which is 1/8. So this is one case, and you can test with all the possibilities. I will not show this. So it's, no, it is almost finished for the people who are online. This is the proof, which is for the generic case, which is a bit long, and I didn't plan to present this at the beginning. So you will be able to read it if you want after the talk. And the experimental setup of BB84 can be the one used, the experimental setup used by NRSP. So in the middle, you have the Bell pair source.
Ludovic, yeah. I'm sorry. I think you should go quite quickly to the conclusion.
No, it is almost the last the last slide.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, it is. It will be the last slide. Showing how it can be done, realized physically. So you can use the LRSP experimental results in which you have the production of a bell pair in the middle for the quantum channel, as here. And you have the measurement of the qubits using the beam splitting polarizer here and the photodiode here to get the zero and the one. By moving the beam splitter beam splitting polarizer here, you change you can choose the axis if you can move them fast, and this is feasible with some non manually of course, but with some electro optic materials with changing quickly the voltage, you can do realize this kind of thing. And I think I will finish here. I had finished on this part. So just this one, I will not present is another principle using the Bell's inequality, Eckert 91. I didn't plan to present this. And for the conclusion, for the product, there are some products existing with some possibilities to, so it is ID quantic, possibility to produce key at a rate of few kilobits per second. They are commercially available over fiber distance of 60 kilometers. And I will finish with this. Today's quantum key distribution systems, few tens of kilometers in fiber communication. There are also some possibilities by satellite of few hundreds of kilometers. To increase the distance, one should use quantum buffers and quantum teleportation, but they are not yet mature technologies. One can also use optical switching to perform quantum routing. There exist mature technologies for that. And quantum Ethernet used both quantum teleportation, quantum buffers, and quantum and optical switching to perform quantum key distribution between any pair of endpoints in quantum networks. And this is the topic in which I am interested in. So thank you for your attention. And I was a bit long, yeah. As usual, I would say.
Thank you very much, Ludovic. I think we can applaud the speaker.
So,
are there any questions in the room or on the bridge?
There is a question in the room.
Yeah, about the one false probability of the why to detect beep like in the sitting. Like, I've written like there are like 11% for the threshold to perform of the cuber of performing GPD or the beep has eavesdrop because beep might try to resend the same bit as she has received, so I get a fourth too big.
I think it is 1/4. Maybe we'll discuss this later. You say it is
the possibilities, but not the probabilities to get to the 1/4, because Eve might try to resend the same bits, which is due to the no cloning paradox, no cloning. Not accurate that the security proofs that came to the 11%, and here is only the possibilities which are looked to get to the 1/4, but it's not so possibility.
I try to have for me it was 1/4, and maybe we'll have discussed
on 1/4, 1/8.
It depends on which you get. It's 1/4 on when they choose the same axis. So it is 1/8 if it is if you consider all the cases.
Possibilities, but not the probabilities, because Eve would try to resend the same bit in the same axis she would have measured.
Yeah, this is what I use. What the use case that you here. She measure here, she really measure in a given access that here is zero. If you have one, it is the same, in fact, instead of zero. The color of the boxes will change, but at the end, you will obtain the same probability. But here, the Eve choose the same axis. She measures something, and she sends what she measured to Bob. It's really this case here. And I have, so 1/8. But because we are considering only the case when the axis measure are the same, this is what this is one. I put it 1/4, but it is 1/8 in the total configuration. So 12.5%, 12.5%. It depends what. Maybe I should have written 1/8. But the way I define for myself the probability of detection is. In the case when the when Alice and Bob show the same axis, so it is 1/2 of the case. So you need to divide 1/4 by 1/2 if you want to have it on one on the all the possibilities. And you see the range cases, it's 1/32 in terms of probability, 4 times, which is 1/8. But among all the possibilities.
I might have one other question, like about the matching apparatus, which has a intent the beams, the detection beams, trigger for painting, or it might be adjusted by voltage. And what are the advantages or disadvantages compared to like the intensity beam splitter and then two polarization beam splitters, which would perform the randomized measurement?
I need to think about it. I'm not sure it is equivalent, but maybe I need to think about it and then we discuss. This together, if you want. We are in the same corridor, so we can discuss.
Okay, cool.
I need to discuss. Yeah.
You said something which bothered me. You said Eve knows the axis, she only knows them afterwards, right?
She knows the axis that Alice and Bob can choose, but she does not know the value before Alice and Bob exchange it.
That was not clear.
Yeah, yeah, sorry, I was too fast.
So if you gets typical access to the open channel, she can completely stop Alice and Bob from sharing a key. Blocking.
Okay.
You
in fact, what she can do also is she can cut the fiber, and the mode cannot communicate anywhere.
Undetected, but she definitely just like
it will be detected.
Communication, she can.
Yeah.
Communication that you can.
Well, this will not prevent F to stop the communication between Alice and Bob. But what this quantum key disruption mechanism does, it prevents F to get some information without being detected. This is the major aspect, the important aspect of quantum key disruption.
Okay.